Hello everyone, welcome to Catalysis by Vedantu. My name is Pahul. You've already seen things about me. So people, welcome to yet another episode of Let's Revit. And today we are going to revise a chapter that doesn't really need to be revised because it's a very basic chapter. But still, since it is one of those chapters which finds their applicability in almost every other chapter, we are going to revise this as well. So in case I'm audible and visible, please write "you" in the chat box. You know the drill. Yeah, and we will get to your doubts later. Cool. So chalo dosto, aaj it'll not take a lot of time for us to revise, so let's quickly revise all the concepts that were there in the chapter of the mole concept, and then we shall talk to each other as we usually do. Cool. Are you ready? Let's get into the chapter of the mole concept. Yeah. So people, in the beginning, yeah, essentially the idea was that we have to define the atomic mass unit. So one atomic mass unit was essentially defined as the mass of the carbon 12 isotope divided by 12. We specially chose the carbon 12 isotope because of historical reasons. Earlier they chose hydrogen. Hydrogen didn't work because hydrogen itself was too small to be measured properly. Then they chose oxygen, but at the time that they had chosen oxygen, people didn't know about the isotopes of oxygen. So they thought they're working with the weight of oxygen 16, but in fact they were working with the average weight of all the isotopes. So that failed at that time. Then later on people said that now we have spectroscopy, let's just choose a specific standard. And at that time carbon was just a convention that everyone chose because in the 1950s chemists were using carbon quite a lot in mass spectroscopic studies. Yeah, so just a choice to choose carbon. Could have chosen any other element as well. Carbon just works. Yeah, so carbon 12 isotopes, mass divided by 12. In case you want to look at the mathematics of it all, this is what it is. Mass of one carbon 12 atom is 1.99 into 10 to the power minus 23 grams. This information will hardly ever be useful. Still, it is there because revision. One Dalton is also a fancier word for one atomic mass unit. And this is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 24 grams. This information might be useful. Okay, this information might be useful, so you might want to remember this particular part. It's very simple. 1.66 into 10 to the power minus 24 grams is one atomic mass unit. And again, if you think of a box of carbon atoms of 12 grams, you are essentially deriving the mole. So one mole is equal to 6.022 into 10 to the power 23. Yeah, this is your Avogadro's number, so we also represent it as Na, N subscript A, not sodium. It might look like sodium right now. It's not sodium. It's just N with a tiny subscript of A at the bottom. Avogadro's number. This was simple. And then comes stoichiometry. Yeah. So stoichiometry, maybe I have a specific technique that you would know if you've seen my full class of stoichiometry. But there's no need for you to see that if you are targeting for 2020 examinations. I'll quickly tell you what that technique is. Okay. Let's say you have, whatever, say any random example le raha hu main. 5A plus 7B. Gives me 2C plus 9D. Okay, let's say this is a very weird chemical reaction. And initially, let's say I take 20 moles of A. Let's say I take 40 moles of B. We have to tell what is the limiting reagent. So how will we choose the limiting reagent? What we need to do in order to choose that is take the ratio of the initial quantity by the stoichiometric coefficient. So let's just call it ratio R. Ratio for A is 20 by 5. Ratio for B is 40 by 7, just for simplicity. Let me take a multiple of 7 itself. 35 le lete hain, chalo. Theek hai? Yeah. So ratio for B will be 35 by 7. So this is equal to 4, this is equal to 5. Yeah. Limiting reagent ke liye, you just have to choose the smaller ratio. Okay. Smaller ratio gives you the limiting reagent. So over here, do you realize that A is the limiting reagent? A is the limiting reagent over here because its ratio of initial amount of a stoichiometric coefficient is smaller than that of B. A is the limiting reagent. Now, limiting reagent defines the perfect scenario. So in the perfect scenario, you would have 20 moles of A. the excess of B you have to throw it away, or you have to keep it somewhere in your cupboard in the chemical laboratory. So let's say X moles of B is used. फटाफट से इसको करेंगे. यू नो दैट इन द परफेक्ट सिनेरियो ऑल द रेशियोज विल बी इक्वल. सो आई कैन से x by 7 ओके इज इक्वल टू 20/5 इज इक्वल टू 4. सो x इज इक्वल टू 28. सो एसेंशियली इन अ परफेक्ट सिनेरियो 28 मोल्स ऑफ बी वुड बी यूज्ड. सो माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, कैन यू टेल मी हाउ मेनी आर रिमेनिंग मोल्स ऑफ बी? 7 मोल्स ऑफ बी आर रिमेनिंग. यस, ठीक है. सो 35 - 28, 7 मोल्स ऑफ बी आर रिमेनिंग एंड यू कैन कीप इट इन द फ्रिज. नथिंग ऑफ ए विल रिमेन. एंड फाइनली यू हैव टू फिगर आउट हाउ मच सी एंड डी इज प्रोड्यूस्ड. लेट्स कॉल दिस वाई, लेट्स कॉल दिस जेड. वंस अगेन सेम टेक्निक हैज टू बी अप्लाइड. y/2 ओके इज इक्वल टू z/9. दीज रेशियोज आर इक्वल ऑल ओवर द प्लेस बाय द वे. दिस इज समथिंग दैट यू शुड रिमेंबर. z/9 इज इक्वल टू दिस रेशियो दैट वी बीन वर्किंग विद. Yeah, 20/5 is equal to 4. So from here you can calculate that y is equal to 8. So 8 moles of C will be produced. 36 moles of D will be produced. So on and so forth. ठीक है जी. So this is how stoichiometry works. Very quickly I have told you all of the ideas. It's a pattern. If you were able to revise it here, great. Otherwise you can watch my full long class on stoichiometry, which I've taken like a couple of days back on Saturday. Right. That was stoichiometry. We'll deal with questions of stoichiometry tomorrow at 8:30 when we are doing the questions of this chapter. Yeah. Then you know in mole concept, in any chemical reaction essentially, 100% of the expected product is never formed. Yeah. There is always some loss of product. Sometimes equilibrium reactions don't go entirely towards the products. Yeah. At the end, you will get a reaction mixture and the yield of your desired product will never be 100%. So, percentage yield of your desired product is equal to the actual yield upon theoretical yield into 100. Yeah. So let's say you had predicted theoretical yield bole to, let's say you had predicted that 100 moles will be created, but you realize that the actual yield is only 80 moles. So percentage yield will come out to be 80%. It's like you, let's say you have an apple orchard. Okay. You have an orchard of apples and you were expecting that at the end of the harvesting season, you would get to sell, let's say 100 kilograms of apples. You have a tiny orchard of yours. So you were expecting that you will get 100 kilograms of apples, but ultimately because of some weather conditions were not suitable, some of your trees fell prey to some insects, etc., etc., you got only 75 kilograms of apples. So your percentage yield of apples in your orchard has been 75%. That's the basic idea, applies to everything and anything. Happens in chemical reactions as well, and this is a very important thing. One thing that we'll definitely discuss in tomorrow's questions. After discussing the basics of what is the mole, what is stoichiometry, what is percentage yield, this chapter takes a turn into understanding more about solutions. Yeah, it is necessary that if I'm giving you a recipe, I tell you the exact amounts of everything that I've taken. Yeah, if I tell you the recipe that I make of can't think of a recipe right now. Let's say I make Schezwan noodles. Yeah. So the recipe of Schezwan noodles that I have, I put some noodles, I put some sauce, I put some garlic, I put some chili, I put some namak. If I tell you this, you might be able to make the Schezwan noodles. You might not be able to make the Schezwan noodles because the proportions might be off. Yeah. But if you tell you exactly that you need 1 cup of noodles, you need this much amount of water, you need 1 spoon of salt, you need 2 tablespoons of the Schezwan sauce, etc., then you'll be able to make the recipe perfectly. Same thing applies for chemical solutions as well. If you have to transport one solution from one laboratory to the other, or if you have to do some analysis on that solution, you need to know what's the composition of that solution. You need to know the recipe of that particular solution. Yeah. So uske liye there are multiple ways of doing it, and depending on the kind of solution you have, you choose one of these measures. So first thing is mole fraction. Mole fraction is the simplest. Okay, mole fraction is represented as chi. Okay, because if you represent it with M and F, you know what will happen. So chi of any component is essentially equal to the number of moles of that component in the mixture divided by the sum of total number of moles. I hope you understand this notation right now. Okay. जितने भी कॉम्पोनेंट्स हैं. सो मोल फ्रैक्शन इज अ वेरी वर्सटाइल टर्म. यू कैन चूज इट फॉर अ सोल्यूशन दैट हैज एनी नंबर ऑफ कॉम्पोनेंट्स इन इट. इट कुड बी अ सॉलिड सोल्यूशन, लिक्विड सोल्यूशन, गैस सोल्यूशन, सॉलिड इन लिक्विड इन गैस, ऑल ऑफ दैट. मोल फ्रैक्शन इज अ वेरी वर्सटाइल आइडिया. इट्स जस्ट द फ्रैक्शन ऑफ मोल्स ऑफ द एंटायर कॉम्पोनेंट. एंड यू वुड नो दैट द समेशन ऑफ ऑल द मोल fractions inside a solution is equal to 1. This is also a very idea because fractions add up to 1. Yeah. So, ye to simple hai. Then you have mass percentage. Now, these terms are very important. Please make sure you remember them. Mass percentage essentially works in grams of solute in 100 grams of solution. Okay. Grams of solute in grams of solution into 100. Yeah. So, this can be written as grams of solute upon grams of solution into 100. This can be a formula, or you can simply think of it as how much grams of solute is present in 100 grams of, mark my words carefully, solution, not just the solvent, solution. The entire mixture has how much of this per 100 grams, yeah? Fine. So let's say you get a namkeen mixture from the bazaar and it says that the entire packet is 100 grams. Out of that, 10 grams is cashew. Yeah. So, out of the entire 100 grams of a packet, 10 grams is cashew. So, mass percent of cashew in that mixture would be 10%. Very simple. So, this is used when you have solid solutions. Okay, mass percent makes a lot of sense when you have solid solutions. When you start doing solid and liquid solutions, okay, then you jump to things like mass per unit volume. What does this mean? Okay, this is something sometimes written as W by V percentage. Okay, this is written as W by W percentage. Mass percent is written as W by W. Mass by volume percent. Okay, yahan pe percent aana chahiye ek. Mass by volume percent essentially refers to mass of solute in grams present in 100 milliliters of solution. So again, grams of solute upon milliliters of solution into 100. Okay, this is the idea over there. Cool. So mass of solute in grams present in 100 milliliters of the solution. 100 milliliters is very important over here. Okay? 100 milliliters is very important over here. Then we move on to volume by volume percentage. Okay, volume by volume. If it is written as V by V percent, then this is you can take it in, let's say, liters of solute divided by liters of solution into 100. Yeah? It's essentially the percentage of a certain solute in the entire volume. Yeah? V by V percent. Very simple idea. So this is something that you would see in your cough syrups as well sometimes. Most of the times it's mentioned in weight by volume. But sometimes when you have liquid and liquid solutions, you refer to them in volume by volume percentage. Very simple idea. Okay. Then you have grams per liter. Is there anything to discuss in this? No. Grams of solute in 1 liter of solution. Again, mark the word solution in all of these cases. Okay. Parts per million. Now, this is also very simple. You can talk about it in terms of mass. You can talk about it in terms of volume. Yeah, essentially parts. So if I take 1 cup of rice in 2 cups of water, yeah, I have 1 cup of rice in 2 cups of water. I can call it 1 part of rice in 2 cups or 2 parts of water. The part I'm taking over here is a volume of 1 cup. It could be mentioned in terms of mass as well. ठीक है, सो पार्ट्स कुड रेफर टू मास, कुड रेफर टू वॉल्यूम, डिपेंड्स ऑन द क्वेश्चन. वी विल बी एबल टू डिसाइफर दैट इफ दिस कम्स इनटू अ क्वेश्चन. देख के पता लग जाता है वेदर यू हैव टू थिंक अबाउट मास और वॉल्यूम. एसेंशियली मास ऑफ सोल्यूट अपॉन मास ऑफ सोल्यूशन इनटू 10 to the power 6. हाउ मेनी पार्ट्स ऑफ द सोल्यूट आर प्रेजेंट इन अ मिलियन. या हाउ मेनी पार्ट्स ऑफ सोल्यूट आर प्रेजेंट इन अ मिलियन पार्ट्स ऑफ द सोल्यूशन. पार्ट्स पर मिलियन. सिमिलरली पार्ट्स पर बिलियन कैन बी डिफाइंड एंड दैट इज इक्वल टू I would write parts over here instead of mass to give a more broad definition. Parts of solute upon parts of solution into 10 to the power 9. Yeah, parts per billion. Cool. So parts per million, parts per billion, these things are very obvious when you talk about them, and they're used to calculate things like pollution percentages, because in air the amount of pollutants is very less, although that is also very harmful for us. The amount of fluoride ion that you put in your toothpaste, that is also I think measured in parts per million itself. Cool. तो ये भी हो गया. देन कम्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट यूनिट ऑफ मोलैरिटी. दिस इज समथिंग दैट वील यूज ऑल द टाइम इन आर क्वेश्चन एंड दैट इज मोल्स ऑफ सोल्यूट अपॉन लीटर्स ऑफ सोल्यूशन. Essentially, that can be thought of as number of moles of solute in 1 liter of solution. Okay, so I can think about it as number of moles of solute in 1 liter of solution. The solution is very important. ठीक है भैया, solution. Now, on the other hand, there is something called molality. And why is molality chosen? Why is molality a good unit? Because molality, my dear friends, is temperature independent. Okay, this is one main reason why molality is also used. Okay, so molality is essentially moles of solute upon mass of solvent. ठीक है, moles of solute upon mass of solvent. This is the only measure over here for concentration that talks in terms of a solvent. Baki sab solution, only molality is talking about the solvent. So it's easier to deal with that. I take 1 spoon of salt and dissolve it in 1 kilogram of water. Very easy to talk about it and has a lot of applicability. We've seen its applicability in solutions chapter as well. So this is temperature independent because it doesn't have any term of volume in it. If you see, this has a term of volume, it is temperature dependent. Parts per million, if talked about in terms of volume, will be temperature dependent, but in terms of mass, it's not temperature dependent. In terms of volume as well, the dependency might cancel each other out depending on whether the solution and solute expand or contract in the same way in the volume. But if it is talked out in terms of mass, then it is also temperature independent. This is temperature dependent, this is temperature dependent. Out of these, mole fraction is temperature independent, mass percent is temperature independent, mass per volume is temperature dependent, because volume can change with temperature. Spent a little bit of time over here, very easy ideas. We've discussed these in solutions chapter as well. Now, the page that I have over here in front of you, these are some formulas that a lot of people tend to remember. Yeah, my dear friends, I will tell you one thing very important, that these formulas are useless. Okay, trust my words when I say this. If in physical chemistry you are memorizing big formulae, you are doing it wrong. Because these ideas can be thought about as logic. Yes, you know what molality is. You know what molality is. Molality is moles of solute upon kilograms of solvent. Molality is moles of solute upon liters of solution. If you have density, you can relate the liters to kilograms. Once you do that, you can separate the kilograms of the solute and the solution. You can get to molality as well. The point is that questions related to these ideas, which come time and again in mains and advanced and NEET. Okay, this is a very favorite part for all these examinations. We'll definitely see a question from this part in tomorrow's solving class. But the thing is, yaar, you don't need to remember these formulae because these are very obvious. Okay, since we know the basic ideas behind molality, mole fraction, molarity, etc., we can relate to them from a very basic step-by-step procedure. No need to remember these formulae and cram up extra space in your brain. So, in case you want to remember them, good. If you don't remember them, I'll tell you, to remember them is already useless. Then comes dilution law. So people, let's just see an example. Let's talk about mixing and dilution at the same time. Thinking about the same solute in both of the cases, let's say you have M1 and V1 in dabba A, and in dabba B, dabba means box, you have M2 and V2. Yeah, molarity to V2, and we are thinking about the same solute and solvent in both of these cases. Yeah. When we add them together, what will happen? The final box C that you have, a bigger box, this will have total volume how much? V1 plus V2. What is the total number of moles in this box? Number of moles will simply be added. So total number of moles in this box will be M1 into V1 plus M2 into V2. So can you tell me what's the final molarity of this dabba? Final molarity, which is represented by capital M final, that is equal to M1 V1 plus M2 V2 divided by the total volume, that is V1 plus V2. Essentially what we've done is we've just taken total number of moles and divided by the total volume. That's what molarity is, isn't it? So no need to worry about the formula over here. Very simple. And when will this be dilution? This will be dilution when M2 is equal to 0. Yeah. If M2 is equal to 0, just divide, just cancel this out. That there are no moles of new solute in the B box. Only volume is being added. So you just do M1 V1 by V1 plus V2. Dilution is also taken care of. All you need to worry about is, yeah, all you need to worry about is the number of moles. Number of moles have to be conserved, that's all. Very simple ideas, dilution and mixing. So once this is done, people, we move on to ideas of equivalent concept. Yeah, equivalent concept ki baat aati, and equivalent concept is very simple to understand. Yeah, because when we take acids like H2SO4, one mole of that acid can give me 2 moles of H positive. So one equivalent of acid can be thought of as just that amount of acid which will give me 1 mole of H positive. So do you agree that half a mole of H2SO4 will give me 1 mole of H positive? Absolutely obvious. So that is where the definition of equivalence comes into picture, and we'll extrapolate it to bigger ideas as well. So mass of an acid which furnishes 1 mole of H positive is called its equivalent mass. Mass of base which furnishes 1 mole of H negative is called its equivalent mass. Okay, it's like ordering one plate of gulab jamun. One plate of gulab jamun is as good as 2 gulab jamuns. Yeah. So do you understand? Equivalence talks about the same thing in moles, but from a different perspective, that's all. Okay. So then comes the idea of valency factor. And valency factor is essentially the amount of charge that displaces itself in the reaction whenever an acid or a base or a salt or an oxidizing agent or a reducing agent is reacting. If we think about it in terms of acid, it's very simple. The number of H positives furnished by one molecule is the valency factor. Yeah. So valency factor is number of H positive supplied by one molecule of acid, or the number of OH negative ion supplied by one molecule or 1 mole of the base. This is pretty simple. Yeah. So for example, if you have AlOH whole thrice, if this guy acts as a base, then the valency factor over here will be 3. So my dear friends, the equivalent weight would be molecular weight divided by Z, because 1 mole of AlOH3 will be able to give me 3 OH negatives. So 1 mole of OH negative will be obtained by 1 mole of AlOH divided by 3. Yeah. So equivalent weight or equivalent mass is equal to molecular mass divided by Z. Z or Z. Z is your valency factor. And number of equivalents is essentially the weight of acid upon equivalent weight. Badi simple si baat hai. You just have to think about how much moles of OH negative or H positive are you getting. Very obvious idea. The thing is that we'll be able to understand this better when we solve questions tomorrow. I might take your doubts later while chatting. But what you need to worry about is how to calculate the valency factor. Once you have the valency factor, life is very simple. Okay. Once you have the valency factor, life is very simple. And valency factor is calculated for different things differently. This is something that you should definitely note down. And I will anyway give you the PDF of this class in some time. So for an acid, the number of H positives that it can provide from 1 mole is the valency factor. Number of OH negatives that a base can provide from 1 mole is its valency factor. On an ion, the magnitude of charge on that ion is the valency factor. Yeah, so for example, you have, let's say you have N3 negative. Let's just imagine this ion exists. Okay, so what will be the valency factor for this ion? Valency factor will be 3. Alright, as simple as that. Let's take a more practical example that you would see quite often. Let us take CO32 negative. This is a good radical that we have. CO32 negative, yeah. So it has a 2 negative charge. So my dear friends, over here the valency factor for CO32 negative will be equal to 2. Because whenever it reacts, it will react in ratios of 2. Yeah. The charge on that species will dictate how it reacts with something else. So that reaction will happen in units of 2, hence the valency factor is also 2. Okay. Then comes salt. Once again, the total positive or total negative charge furnished by one molecule of salt. Let's just take an example of a salt of the carbonate itself. Let's take sodium carbonate. Yeah. What is the total positive charge on it? Plus 2. What is the total negative charge on it? Minus 2. So again, the valency factor over here will become 2. Theek hai ji? Very simple. So you just have to think about the total positive charge or the total negative charge. And when it comes to oxidizing agents or reducing agents, we have to do a redox reaction class as well. So in that class, we will see how to figure out the equivalent factor of oxidizing agents and reducing agents. It's very simple. So number of electrons lost or gained by a molecule of oxidizing agent or reducing agent is the valency factor. Yeah, so you know that like KMnO4 in different conditions loses different amount of electrons. So for different conditions, its valency factor is different. What are the exact values? We'll discuss it in our redox revision class. But yeah, I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. Cool. So valency factors are very important. They help us solve some questions easier than by just using the mole concept. So even if your syllabus doesn't mention equivalent concept explicitly, in some places they say that equivalent is not in syllabus. But the thing is that this technique helps us solve questions much faster. And hence we need to know this technique, especially for the chapter of oxidizing and reducing agents as well. One special case of calculating the equivalent weight is for a hydrated salt where there is H2O present inside the reaction mixture. Inside the salt itself. For example, washing soda, NO2CO3.10H2O. So the thing is that water over here is not catering to the valency factor. Only NO2CO3 is catering to the valency factor, yes. Water is just going to go and dissolve in the solution. So water will contribute to the equivalent weights numerator, but the denominator, which is just the valency factor, water has nothing to do with it. So over here, can I say that the valency factor is equal to 2? Very nice, you know, Na 2 positive, CO3 2 negative, it will still react in ratios of 2. So it just contributes, salt contributes to the charge, water just contributes to the total mass. So total mass of this salt is equal to 286, divide that by the valency factor and you will get the equivalent weight. Okay, so for hydrated salt, this is how you have to calculate the equivalent weight. You just take the valency factor, okay ji, aur chakke divide kar do, khatam baat. Very simple idea. Cool, right? Awesome. Now let's come to law of chemical equivalence, with which we'll also try to understand things about titration. If you have a reaction A plus B B, yeah, is giving you C times C plus D times D, essentially this can be written as one equivalent of A reacts with one equivalent of B, I'll just write EQ for equivalence, okay, to give one equivalent of C and one equivalent of D. And since tomorrow's class is an advanced level class, we will definitely do problems that are related to equivalent concept. 100% we'll do problems related to this particular idea, right? So do you understand how you can work with titration in this case? Let's say you are doing a titration. This is the flask that you have your solution in. Kuch to yahan pe dal rakha hai aapne, maan lo. Okay, and then you have the burette as well. Cool. So in the burette, let's say you've taken the known solution. That's what we generally do, right? So let us say you know that the number of the valency factor of this solution is, let's just take an example. Theek hai, maan lo ye hai H2SO4. And at the bottom you have NaOH. Yeah. What are the pieces of information that I know? I know that for NaOH valency factor is equal to 1. And let's say I know that the volume that I've taken for this solution is 30 milliliters. Let's assume. For H2SO4, since it's a known solution, I know the facts that the valency factor is equal to 2, because H2SO4. Yeah, valency factor is equal to 2. Let's say the molarity of this solution is equal to 0.7. I'm taking random values from the top of my head. And the volume that is used to neutralize the NaOH is equal to, let's say, 60 milliliters. That's too much. Itni badi burette hoti nahi hai. So let us just do 10 milliliters. Chalo. My dear friends, can we calculate the molarity of this guy? Very simple. The same number of equivalents of both of these things will react. Yeah. So what can I write over here? For NaOH, the equivalents are going to be equal to the equivalents of H2SO4. इक्विवेलेंट्स आर इक्वल टू जेड इंटू नंबर ऑफ मोल्स, इजंट इट, है ना जी? नंबर ऑफ मोल्स इंटू द वैलेंसी फैक्टर इक्वल टू नंबर ऑफ इक्विवेलेंट्स, एज सिंपल एज दैट. So on the left hand side I will write 1 into molarity that I don't know into volume. Yeah, molarity into volume is equal to number of moles. I hope you understand. Since volume in both sides is on milliliters, no need to convert it into liters. They'll anyway cancel each other out. Is equal to 2 into 0.7 into 10. So my dear friends, can you tell me what is this question mark now? What is this question mark equal to now? गंदा सा कैलकुलेशन ले लिया मैंने, बट क्वेश्चन मार्क इज इक्वल टू 1.4 डिवाइड बाय 3. ठीक है, तो दिस इज द मोलैरिटी ऑफ NaOH, इजंट इट? एज सिंपल एज दैट, नथिंग कॉम्प्लिकेटेड अबाउट इट. सो दिस इज हाउ टाइट्रेशंस वर्क. ओके, दिस वाज अ वेरी सिंपल एसिड बेस्ड टाइट्रेशन. इफ यू आर डूइंग रिडॉक्स टाइट्रेशन, ऑल यू नीड टू नो इन रिडॉक्स टाइट्रेशंस एज वेल इज जस्ट द वैलेंसी फैक्टर्स ऑफ बोथ द सब्सटेंसेस दैट आर रिएक्टिंग. In case you know the redox reaction of those substances, you will be able to calculate the valency factor, and we'll see those questions in our redox class, which is I think at the end of this week or at the end of next week. Very soon we have a redox class as well. So yeah, stay subscribed to the channel to see that. Very simple idea. Cool. Nothing too complicated about it. Equivalents are the same, right? Very nice. And now, my dear friends, there is a concept of equivalent volume of gas as well. So this was just to revise that 1 mole of gas occupies 22.4 liters at standard temperature and pressure. What is standard temperature pressure? 0 degree Celsius, 1 bar. ठीक है? This is your standard temperature and pressure. Very old definition. So 1 mole of gas at standard temperature and pressure occupies 22.4 liters. Okay, so one equivalent of a gas will occupy 22.4 liter divided by the equivalent mass, divided by the valency factor, isn't it? Very obvious idea, yeah. If 1 mole of oxygen gas is there, okay, so let's say you have 1 mole of O2 gas, right? You know that for O2, what is the valency factor? For one oxygen, the valency factor is 2. For one oxygen, valency factor is equal to 2. And you'll be like, sir, why? See, this is applicable in most cases, not in all cases. When you're talking about peroxides and superoxides, the thing is a little different. But do you realize that oxygen will always want to convert into O2 negative? Almost always. Yeah. So oxygen will also react in ratios of 2. So one oxygen has the valency factor of 2. Two oxygens will have a valency factor of 4. So, my dear friends, what is going to be the equivalent weight of, equivalent volume of O2 gas? 22.4 divided by 4 is equal to equivalent volume of O2 gas. ठीक है? Similarly, for Cl2 gas, Cl2 gas and H2 gas, for both of these, the valency factor is going to be 2 because one chlorine goes to Cl negative. One hydrogen goes to H positive. So for one chlorine and one hydrogen, valency factor is 1 and 1. But when you have two chlorines, two hydrogens, valency factor becomes 2. Their equivalent volumes are 11.2 liters. And I'm saying chlorine and hydrogen, I mean to say Cl2 and H2. Obviously, they don't exist as gases in their atomic states. Fine. Very simple idea yet again. And finally, when we take equivalence into account to calculate the concentration, we come to the idea of normality. We come to the idea of normality that is equal to equivalence of solute upon volume of solution. So, my dear friends, can you tell me the relationship between molarity and normality? Let's try to write it over here. No need to get confused. Some people do get confused. Likh ke dekhte hain, right? Molarity is equal to moles of solute upon liters of solution. Yes. Now, how can we calculate the moles of any substance? How can we calculate the moles of any substance if I have equivalence? Again, think about it in terms of H2SO4. Okay. For H2SO4, okay, one equivalent is equal to half a mole. Yes. So, if I have 1 mole of H2SO4, that is equal to 2 equivalents. So how do I convert moles into equivalents? I just have to multiply that into the valency factor. Yes, I just have to multiply that into valency factor. So moles of solute upon liter of solution into valency factor is equal to equivalence of solute upon liters of solution. This is equal to normality. So my dear friends, always remember that normality is equal to the z factor into molarity. ठीक है जी? Very very simple idea. Just have to take z factor into molarity. Very simple idea. Okay. So sometimes people get confused that do I divide it or multiply it? Just do this tiny little analysis in your mind. Yeah. Molarity equals to moles upon liters. Moles to equivalence. You have to multiply the valency factor. Equivalence by liters is normality. ठीक है, सो वेलेंसी फैक्टर, जेड फैक्टर, वॉट एवर यू वॉन्ट टू कॉल इट, दिस इज हाउ इट वर्क्स. सो माई डियर फ्रेंड्स, इन अ मेयर 35 मिनट्स टाइम वी वर एबल टू रिवाइज द एंटायर चैप्टर. नाउ रिवाइजिंग दिस चैप्टर जस्ट किल्स लाइक 25% ऑफ द एंटायर चैप्टर फॉर द एग्जामिनेशन. टुमोरो वी हैव टू डू क्वेश्चंस ऑन दिस चैप्टर, एंड वंस वी डू दैट, that is when you will get better at it. Now what I'll do is, as you know, if you are an old student, we will see some information about the crash course. If you are new, then definitely this information about the crash course will be helpful for you. Just see that information. I will generate the PDF of whatever I've taught you today, then I will share the PDF with you and we'll chat with each other for a couple of minutes. Cool. Here's the information for you. Exams are really close, and at this time, if you're not satisfied with your preparation, I'm sure you're stressed out. Don't worry, lots of improvements are possible in this short span of time if you get good guidance. And for that, Vedantu brings you crash courses for JEE and NEET. These live sessions will happen on Vedantu's patented platform. So your interaction with the teachers will be really good and you can solve your doubts much better. As a part of this course, you will get a lot of study material, short notes for theory, short videos for revision, basic level, advanced level, multiple choice questions, previous year analysis, etc. You'll also be a part of the test series in this course. You'll get to take lots of mock tests regularly so that you can analyze your progress throughout this course. Also, all the live sessions, their recordings will be made available to you so that you can revise them again anytime you want. Now, in order to enroll for these courses, the links are right here on the screen. You can type them in your web browser. These links are also down in the description box. Since you are a regular student at Catalysis, I will give you a discount code. Use this to get a really good discount. I know these advertisements can become annoying and irritating at times. Well, only because some of you choose to purchase these courses, we at Vedantu are able to provide so much free education. Thank you so much for your support, because we are nothing without you, Vedantu. Alrighty, people. Thank you so much for watching that. In case you do want to enroll in the crash courses, then the links and all the details are once again in the pinned comment down below, also in the descriptions box. So just scroll through the descriptions and you will find whatever you need in case you want to enroll for the crash course. All right. The link to the PDF is also in the comment section, and I've pinned the comment as well. Yes. Chalo ji, ab batao. क्या हाल चाल? कृतिका, डू यू सी दैट ओनली वन एच पॉजिटिव इज रिएक्टिंग? दैट्स व्हाई. So for every different condition, the equivalent weight is different. And Kratika is asking, sir, in the reaction of NaOH plus H3PO4, which gives you NaH2PO4 plus H2O, why is the equivalent mass of H3PO4 given as m by 1? Why isn't it given as m by 3? Because in that reaction, only one H positive is reacting. If three H positives were reacting, then do you understand the ratios would be in terms of threes? But right now the ratio is in terms of just one unit. That is why the valency factor is 1. Okay. धनु, एज आई टोल्ड यू, अच्छा यू आर सेइंग दैट फॉर डबल सॉल्ट्स इफ दे आयनाइज विद अन इक्वल चार्जेस. सी धनु, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल व्हेन यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट डबल सॉल्ट्स, टू टॉक अबाउट देम इन इक्विवेलेंट कॉन्सेप्ट इट विल बी अ वेरी वियर्ड आइडिया. ठीक है, सो रादर नॉट डू दैट. इन केस यू स्टिल वॉन्ट टू डू दैट, देन अगेन डिपेंड्स ऑन द रिएक्शन दैट दो सॉल्ट्स विल अंडरगो. ओके, सो अगेन दैट डिपेंड्स ऑन केस टू केस बेसिस. धनु, वी कांट रियली से दैट दिस वुड बी द वेलेंसी फैक्टर. वी हैव टू लुक एट द रिएक्शन इन विच द डबल सॉल्ट इज पार्टिसिपेटिंग. ठीक है, सो इंटरेस्टिंग क्वेश्चन, बट अगेन इट विल डिपेंड ऑन द क्वेश्चन इट सेल्फ. अदिति सिंह, नींद बहुत आती है तो सो जाओ अदिति. वम्सी इज आस्किंग फॉर अ फिजिक्स चैनल एज वेल. इट विल हैपन इवेंचुअली, स्लोली एंड स्टेडली थिंग्स विल हैपन. प्रतीक सिंह, विल द एग्जाम्स गेट फर्दर पोस्टपोन? आई डोंट थिंक सो ब्रो, एवरीथिंग इज गेटिंग अनलॉक्ड राइट नाउ, एंड बाय द एंड ऑफ नेक्स्ट मंथ, व्हेन योर एग्जाम्स आर मिड ऑफ नेक्स्ट मंथ, things will be mobilized. You people will have to wear masks in the examination. You people will have to take sanitizers with you. You people will have to sit far from each other, not talk, etc., etc., be tested for temperature, all of that jazz. So sab kuch hoga, things will be a little different, things will be a little complicated, but they will definitely happen. Theek hai, Bathinde wala, thank you man. Rushikesh, I'm glad you enjoyed it. Neeru is asking, valency factor is the oxidation state? Depends on the reaction once again. So for those ideas, please join us for tomorrow's question solving class, and we'll also do redox reactions very soon. The schedule is down in the description. So jab hoga tab aur maza aayega. Okay. Krishika is asking if there's a coordinate compound like K4FeCN6 sold twice. K4FeCN6, then what will be the valency factor of that compound, 4 or 6? See, in most likelihood it's going to be 4, theek hai? Because the total positive charge on that species is 4, yeah, total negative charge on that species is also 4. So in most likelihood the reactions that will happen will be ionic reactions and the valency factor will be 4. But in case the coordination entity itself breaks apart and does reactions, then depends on the reaction what the valency factor will be. Then depends on the ratios in which these things react. So to use valency factor, to use equivalent concept in every reaction is not a wise choice. But where you can do so, which we'll see tomorrow, it makes calculations much easier. Okay? So you have to make a judicious decision whether you have to, you know, calculate the valency factor or not. And for these weird ambiguous cases, if they want you to calculate the valency factor, they'll give you the reaction itself. Usme dekhte clear ho jayega. Akshat, I recommend you do previous year papers. If you are done with those, then you can choose any book whatsoever. Every book has good questions. Just do the advanced level questions. Yeah. Ruma is saying law of chemical combinations and concept of volume. See, law of chemical combinations is not a law. It's just talking about stoichiometry, isn't it? Law of chemical equivalence, we already told today. And the ones that you're talking about, wo Dalton's law of, kya kehte hain? Reciprocal combinations, multiple combinations, yeah, all of those. Hardly do questions get asked from those topics. Previous years, I haven't seen any questions from those. In case you still want to read on those, just do a quick Wikipedia search. So on all the three laws that are there, multiple proportions, direct proportions, in reciprocal proportions, these are the three chemical combination laws, right? There are Wikipedia articles, just go through it quickly. It'll hardly take 15 minutes for you to do that. Concept of oleum as well, we'll see it while doing some questions, okay? Deeksha is saying, can't focus on the exam for 3 hours. Make a habit, it'll take time. It won't happen in just one day. That is why I'm telling you, you have to take mock tests every other day in the week, at least 3 mock tests a week. That's what I suggest you ideally. So when you do that, your body and brain will get habituated to the idea of sitting in one place for a longer time. Theek hai? Wo zaruri hai. Nice, Jen is saying your vibe is so good. Thank you so much, man. Asrayam, Asrayam agencies. Okay, bro is asking how much marks are needed to get into IITs in JEE Advanced. Depends year to year, man. Every year it's different. Okay. Aryan, I've explained it, man. Just watch that slide again, explain it, just revise it and see. Because there are two oxygens in O2, right? I'm not talking about O square. O2, भैया O2 और O2 कौन से O2 की बात कर रहे हो तुम? कंफ्यूज मत हो जाओ, रुको देखते हैं कितने चला गया. हाँ ब्रो, कैन यू सी ओवर हियर दैट फॉर वन ऑक्सीजन विद अ टू नेगेटिव चार्ज द वैलेंसी फैक्टर इज टू. सो व्हेन यू हैव टू ऑक्सीजन, व्हेन एवर इट रिएक्ट, इट विल रिएक्ट इन रेशियोज ऑफ 2+2 बिकॉज देर आर टू ऑक्सीजन इन O2 गैस. दैट इज वाई द वैलेंसी फैक्टर दैट वी हैव टेकन इज 4. सो आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड दैट दिस एंड दिस आर टू डिफरेंट थिंग्स दैट आई हैव रिटन, दे आर नॉट द सेम. ओके मेधा, आई एम ग्लैड यू एंजॉय द सेशंस. चलो पीपल, दलजीत ओके, आई विल डू दैट मैन. कृषिका, नो देयर इज नो रैगिंग इन IITs दीस डेज, दे आर वेरी स्ट्रिक्ट अबाउट इट. कूल, व्हाट्स द इक्विवेलेंट वेट ऑफ पेरोक्साइड एंड सुपर ऑक्साइड, डिपेंड्स ऑन द रिएक्शन. मनोज, इन द केस ऑफ क्या कहते हैं, लाइक यू हैव Na2O2, यस इन दैट केस द इक्विवेलेंट फैक्टर इज 2. व्हेन यू हैव KO2 द इक्विवेलेंट फैक्टर इज 1. ठीक है, सो दैट्स द आइडिया. देवेश इज सेइंग, सर अगर आपका मैथ अच्छा नहीं था देन व्हाई यू गो विद मैथ. ब्रो इट वॉज स्टिल बेटर देन बायोलॉजी. सी व्हेन एवर आई से माई मैथ्स वॉज नॉट गुड, इट मीन्स दैट कंपेयर टू केमिस्ट्री एंड फिजिक्स माई मैथ्स वॉज नॉट गुड. इफ माई मैथ्स वॉज टोटली हॉरिबल आई वुडंट बी एबल टू क्लियर जे. सो आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड, व्हेन आई से माई मैथ वॉज बैड इट इम्प्लाइज दैट माई मैथ रिलेटिव टू केमिस्ट्री एंड फिजिक्स वॉज बैड. Also, I hope you realize that the lack of skill and talent can be compensated with a lot of hard work. So that is what I did for mathematics to try and get it to the best level that I could. Theek hai ji? Chalo, people, I'll take your leave. In case I left any of your queries, please leave them in the comment section down below. I hope this session was helpful. And right now, I'll take your leave. Tomorrow at 8:30, we'll meet again and solve a lot of questions on this chapter. Now, the fun thing is, one thing about the questions from this chapter is you can do anything with them. They're all mathematical. So we'll do them tomorrow. Until that time, bye bye, take care. See you soon.